Well, I have one question that that concerns me, if I
remember it well.
Can you read that out?
Andras, how do you deal with the changes in initial teacher education program, for example, in Hungary, in connection with the students' perceptions?
Well, I did it very specifically that I don't. So I'm getting a snapshot of what's happening now. The students have no idea of what was going on before and what's going to come after them. So what I can do is to ask the students who are finishing now of all their experiences over the 5 years of the university education. I'm going to do the same thing in Portugal and in Hungary. The difference will be that in Portugal the 5 year finishes and the students are getting their degree, whereas in Hungary, after this 5 years, there is one more year of teaching experience that's going to follow. But already in this 5 year, they already had their two subject-specific experiences. So they already had teaching experience, and they won't really have much more at the university during the 6 year. So my co-supervisor decided that they will be adequate enough to give a relevant snapshot of what's happening to the in the program, at least in the for this cohort, that will be somewhat parallel to what I'm not saying that there will be a possibility for these case studies to be really I'm just saying parallel. So they are just parallel case studies. They are parallel enough so that this is what my co-supervisor and my supervisor together decided that's going to be. So I'm not dealing with the changes. I am, however, through the context, and because there is this element of one being in a system that the other one just got out of, will have to deal with this, but just as a context and not in the actual thing.
Can we react?
Yeah, sure.
As far as I can see, I have two questions.
I think Ondash is the second question.
In the meantime? Which one was that?
The first line, I think.
Yeah.
Then how did you choose your sample?
Yeah, this is my question. How did you choose your sample?
Well, there is a time constraint. So we have a 3-year program. So if I'm not using this cohort that is in their last year right now, and or wait one more year for the 6th year to finish, they will finish just at the time that I have to defend my thesis. So that is the problem here. So either I am really rethinking the whole thing and really just concentrating what Professor Kramer was saying on the on just the process of what the students are going through in their professional development or their professional identity, professional knowledge formation, and just, you know, the teacher education program is just the context of it. Or I use them even though it's not perfect, and I will say so, and I will clearly state that. But my co-supervisor said, and I was really happy she did that, she feels that that's gonna be enough. After 5 years, they will have enough to say on the program itself, even though the plus 1 year is still part of their training.
Yeah, I can.
Yeah.
I guess what? How do you choose as reservist tutor from eight sectors? I mean, math, science.
I'm not going to specify a subject. So I'm going to try to be as comprehensive as possible for all high school teachers. So that's, yes, high school teachers is what I chose.
If the first question is also for me, I can briefly say something about that. But the second question is definitely for me because it has my name. The element of learner is the student, the learner in the classroom. So yes, I didn't talk too much about it, but in the interviews so far, in the perspectives of teachers, their learners are the central point. So the student learning in the classroom is their central concern. And this is why they kind of engage with innovative practices or engage with additional work, which is of course not paid. Extra or not rewarded, but by the students or by their outcomes. So this is the element I probably missed to elaborate a little bit on. As for my sample, this is a tricky one because especially when you go to a country which you don't really know, and even if you go to a country that you know, how to choose a sample of innovative schools. So this is why, and it connects to my third question, what is innovation? So I needed to first have a clear vision of innovation, which I think so far it's connected to a change of school routine, a change of teacher practices in general. So I used my expert interviews, which were actually placed at the very beginning of my data collection. I used my expert research interviews for understanding which schools I should go, and I also used technical secretariat and my supervisors as basis of knowledgeable input for the sample. Last, the innovation. Yes, this question is a very, very good one, and I like discussing innovation because indeed, if it is something, and innovation as presented in my study, especially from the Portuguese case, is an incremental change. And do I believe that it is necessary to constantly be happening, and why? Yes, I do believe, and this also comes in accordance to what comes from the interviews, that education as it is right now in its majority of practices is lagging behind the what we perceive in outside world when we go out of the school. So, and I'm not saying just about technology or the buildings, it's also about what is taught in the schools and how it's taught. So for instance, changes like having a joint subject or having project-based learning create more organic learning opportunities for students that they can then use it outside, which is taught in innovative schools, especially in the example that I've portrayed, but it's not taught in traditional schools, at least not to my knowledge. So it's or regular schools, however we want to call them. So this is why this is necessary, and this is why it constantly needs to change, and we cannot put our guard down. And do I think that we should then be rethinking the whole concept? I'm not sure if this means rethinking the whole concept of innovation.
No,
or
of education.
Of education. Yes. Yes, I strongly, personally, and professionally believe that we do need to rethink the whole education and how it fits.
So it's more a compromise to work with innovation of incremental change, because this is how the system is, and you personally cannot change the whole thing. Although you would personally rethink the whole thing and build up from zero somehow completely different.
Well, maybe from a positive zero, but yes, something like that. I hope I answered.
I think that question also addressed to you, but it's almost the same as the previous one, just on the right side of it. But I think it is almost the same.
The clash of
it.
Okay, let me check the question. So actually, I think the shorter one is a bit easier, so I'd like to start with that. So what kinds of evidence do I have about the level of difficulty with program-guided summary writing? And I think it refers to what I mentioned, that guided summaries are more difficult to write. Actually, I have to be honest, this is not my evidence. This is previous research. It's already present in the literature. And if somebody is interested in it in more details, my supervisor, Tom Pudula, has a book. I think I put my references. The problem here is me that I put my references on the slides, but I failed to mention them actually. So a 2013 book, it's called Paraphrasing Summarizing, I think. So yeah, so it's paraphrasing and summarizing. And it has detailed accounts about research done on this, whether global summaries are more difficult or less than guided summaries. And the result, in short, is that guided summaries are more cognitively challenging because you have to very specifically focus on particular pieces of information. But that's a good book to start if somebody is interested in details. So I never checked this personally because I started out from previous research to build my own research.
And I have a follow-up because I'm not very familiar with your research area, but in the area of regulation and self-regulation and metacognition, usually the steps are different. So for example, in the basic, try to share the regulation process between the student and between the teachers, so it's in the middle. Maybe so the basic is when the teacher regulates the whole process. For example, she or he gives every task and regulate how they should proceed with reading and learning and so on. And in the middle, this is this shared regulation that the teacher still gives some help or maybe help in understanding text or understanding what they are reading or understanding their task, but also students need some autonomy to do that. And after that, it can be moved to the highest level when they are self-regulating. And based on this theory, I would think about that this guided reading strategy is something, or a guided summary is something that have you to have some focus, so not globally understand the whole reading process. And also, it just came to my mind that so this global summary is that it's really interesting what are the what qualities they have and what are the differences between these global summaries of the students, because I think there can be very big differences between the level of quality and maybe I don't know, so I don't know the area of your research, but I think it from a teaching perspective, you can reconsider that what is the scaffolding or what is the helping in this instruction or reading strategies or the students.
Just to relating this, because my question is referring to, and Professor Pramana just was so kind to answer almost my question. But this is very good, because I think I've already regretted to say the mentor teachers let the mentees do it alone. Of course, there is a huge difference between self-regulated learning and studying alone. One is the conceptual thing, another one is rather a physical one, and it has a huge literature, of course, and I think it was just a slip of the tongue I made, so I can go into details, but sorry.
I see the problem. And initially, this is why this area is so fascinating for me, because this was my standpoint, that when you get direct instruction, like you should only focus on this, should be easier for your mind than for looking for all the gist of a text. Mm-hmm. But it seems like looking for the gist is like the text is leading you. Mm-hmm. So like when you are not the authority there, but the text is kind of the authority with all the main ideas, and the text guides you through the meaning it wants to convey. But the moment you have to focus on something that is not necessarily a main idea in the text, just something that is presented in the text, mm-hmm. you have to reorder this hierarchy, because all the ideas, all the propositions in the text are presented in a hierarchical order. Mm-hmm. And when you are creating the global summary, you have to work together with this hierarchy. Mm-hmm. And with an academic text, this hierarchy is very obvious, because usually you know the topic sentences, the first or the second sentence of the paragraph. Mm-hmm. The text always starts with a thesis statement and with a concluding sentence, so it's quite easy to mm-hmm. get the gist. But when you have to look for a tiny piece of information that might be just a teeny tiny micro proposition mm-hmm. in the whole thing, then it's more difficult, because you still have to process the full text. You have to very thoroughly understand it to be able to fish out the relevant pieces, and I think this guided mm-hmm. summary is the ultimate mm-hmm. level of self-regulation when the student is in charge of their own. Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
so I think it is the other way around mm-hmm. somehow. And with the global summaries, they tend to produce somewhat better global summaries, but this is not coming from research, it's come from teaching experience mostly, mm-hmm. so I cannot really reference it. But they seem to be better at global summaries, even at the first occasion, like the first day of their academic skills classes. It seems to become more natural to them. And the other question is, what happened? Sorry, just a second. Yes, okay. Why do you need to know what happens in the brain when reading? Isn't it enough to find good methods to learn, like how you really want to understand a written text and there is no alternative? Then you will slowly develop your reading for yourself. This is a very good question, thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you. So why I want to understand, because it seems to be, the case seems to be that some students learn very easily how to read effectively, and other students struggle with it for years. And we have very good teaching methods, because all through the country, teachers are teaching how to read academic texts, and they are teaching it with success. But it's not a constant success, not an exponential success, which works with everyone. And if we want to make suggestions for different methods, and if we want to make suggestions for teachers, but my first hunch personally was to get to know what's happening, because we have to build our strategies working together with something, because obviously when we are reading, something goes on in our mind. We can think about the summarization rules or something, or just basic cognitive skills or actions that our brain does involuntarily without our conscious control, so it happens. We cannot work really without them. We cannot counteract them. We have to work with them. But to be able to work with them, we actually have to get a general idea. And I know for sure that we will never be able to know for sure what goes on. And probably it is different for every single student, so there is a big individual difference there. But probably there are general patterns that are present for everybody, and we can work with those, I think. So
we need an adaptive model.
Yes, exactly. We don't need the truth, we need something more practical, more tangible to work with. So, yeah. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. So I have already tried to answer, Professor Kamel already answered my question. I suggest a break now, and let's meet 10 past 11.
Here's a very strict schedule. I designed schedule, yes, but other kind of plans. We got all the doctoral students 3 questions, and I think we should follow those questions. And we start with Helena. Okay. And what do you think? Is it good that we read the questions aloud because we don't know what the other questions? And then we start to think about maybe not. Maybe we put together the 3 questions. We agreed on that, and maybe first we try to answer or give some input for thinking about those questions, and then we can have a discussion involving everybody from here. So you can also give feedback and new thoughts, inspiration for others. Yes. And do you want to read your questions, or should we read? Maybe you can read. If you don't have it, you can read.
I think I have anything like this.
Yes.
So let's see. So since my research is closely, I know the first question, at least that one. The first content-related dilemma, since my research is closely intertwined with the transformative teacher learning for bare student learning in the emerging European context, which is the Edita's framework topic. I was concerned that this element of transformative will not be respectfully represented in my research, or my dilemma is how to respectfully represent this idea of transformative teacher learning. So not only teacher learning like a process of acquiring knowledge or a process of changing skills, but something that actually is more substantial and transformative.
Okay. So I think basically just read those questions because the others are
okay. The second dilemma was related to the design. Since I am a student of ELTE in Hungary and University of Lisbon in Portugal, it was the convenience to take these 2 countries for my case studies. But a part of this convenience, I was wondering how I can give a good scientific justification or rationale to picking my 2 case studies countries. So something that is more robust. I have already tried to start from the background and historical or socio-economical perspective. It doesn't really work. I'm very uncomfortable. But let's see. Let's discuss this issue. I would be keen to understand your perspectives on this. And the last question is, my sample includes lots of stakeholders, but not all the stakeholders. And obviously, when we talk about teacher learning, we can also ask students, parents, local community, and so on, which I'm not asking. So how do I say that I have presented a valid sample selection without implicating my study as slightly incomplete, without having, for instance, student voices or parents or so on?
Okay, thanks. So we can also start with the easier questions, because we thought when we discussed these questions together that the second and the third questions are not so problematic in a sense, for example, in the doctoral study. But of course, we can get your ideas and how can you justify these decisions. So, for example, maybe we can just brainstorm. So for me, I'm not really familiar with the Portugal case or the country context, but. Based on your presentation and what I have seen until now in your from your dissertation, that I think these kinds of moving education from the past to the future, these kinds of orientation, it's really I don't know if it's similar or not, but there is a direction to that, and there are lots of challenges, and there are still this past education that you referred in the quotation, and also new trends and innovation in those countries, so they are together there. So I think that can be a reason for choosing those two countries. And also, I think that that could be also a reason that there are lots of research studies on countries like Great Britain, USA, and so on, regarding innovation in teacher education and teachers' learning. But I don't really know about research studies in Portugal and Hungary. Regarding innovation in teachers' learning. It might be there are some studies, I don't know, but I think that it can be also a reason that not a well-explored countries should be also involved, because, as you mentioned, the context is very important.
Can I answer to this question? As a more specialized in comparative education research, I would say that the comparison of two country systems in itself is already a rich investigation, because normally the research are in the frame of in the main domain of the educational research are in the frames of one national context. So to enlarging the scope of the research to two systems and to go deeply, it will be valid. And you could choose any countries of Europe and it would be valid. But if you are looking at the bigger international comparative studies, you can find that if the research is really deep, is only the comparison of two countries. If there is three, four, five countries in the research, the depth is lost many times. So this is my point of view. And For the third question, I would be interested, what is for you the critical number of the involved interview with person in your research? Because if the number is quite high, focusing on a smaller group would be enough, large enough. If the number of the interviews are smaller, then it would be criticized. But what is the expected number?
It's approximately 35 interviews per country. Mm-hmm. So altogether 70 interviews, which includes experts, teachers, principals, and everyone.
Mm-hmm. I think it will be okay.
Okay.
I read, especially in Australian research financed by the government, and it was a plan for gathering data in the whole countries, and the number of participants was 32, and it was financed by the government officials. So it's more than the average.
Good, thank you.
And I'm connected to this third question as well. So you are asking that there's some kind of gaps in the research, but I think it's very well designed already. And okay, you don't have the students and the parents view, for example, but there will be always limitations within a dissertation. And I think with this 17 interviews is already a huge work. And you are complete in a certain point of view. Of course, in the future you can put there the other views as well. But in the other hand, what is required is that this current population should be equally involved. So these 35 persons are okay as well, I think. So. But it's also important to prepare your data analysis. How do you want to make categories from the answers? How will you make these comparisons? And yeah, I think that's all.
Thank you. Also, we had this first question. Maybe we can react on that also, and then we can have a round. For me, I think I don't know. I won't use any model like this transformative model as exclusively. So I think there are lots of patterns in learning and how learning are combined with innovation in schools. Mm-hmm. And for that reason, I would focus more on identifying those patterns. So sometimes there are no transformation for learners or for teachers or learning teachers in those innovations. Sometimes there are. And I think it also result that what are those cases when there are some transformation in the learning and via innovation in schools. And if it's not so many, I think that's a sign or something that we should consider as a result. So I just wanted to say that. That first, in the first slide, it was the model or something from FACA. Mm-hmm. And I think those kinds of different levels of learning could be important because you can identify different learning gains and learning phase in this innovative context. And one could be also transformative.
And I totally agree because if you starting from one model, there's a huge possibility that you might miss something, mm-hmm. and you just find that paper that factor wasn't involved into yours.
So if I understand correctly, you suggest for searching for patterns and seeing if there is the transformative element and if there is no, and to kind of see what this signals.
For me that would be interesting, and because the contacts are always innovative, or in some aspects innovative.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, so please, if you have any input for the discussion, please, and also if you have a good reason to compare Portugal and Hungary. You know something? Transformative learning. Want to add something?
I would say just a half sentence. Not so much education-wise, but historically, they might be a little bit linked. In the sense of Portugal was a relatively late democracy from dictatorship, and the relatively late inclusion into the European Union, being also on the periphery, even though on the west and not so much on the east of the European Union. Mm-hmm. But so there are two countries, one later was freed and one later was accepted and is on the eastern periphery, but there is a 15-year difference or 20-year difference between them on this level. But it might be, you know, just a little bit of a link between them to see that where or how the innovation of these countries could have been, I don't know, affected by these historical timelines. I'm not sure if it has anything. I basically totally agree that there really need nothing. Just two countries that was easy to get to you and. Just Malia
and basically we covered the same country, so.
Well, yeah, I for example don't do comparative, so I don't care about this part.
No, I don't do comparative.
Oh, so anyway,
comparison is.
It didn't come to mind that I need to make an actual scientific reasoning of why to choose these two countries.
Yeah.
I think most of the scientific literature of comparative just uses, you know, I know that person from that country, so I did my research with that person. And like, you don't really have, I mean, sometimes when there's a huge project with lots of countries, then you think about, I want one Western, I want one Northern, I want an African, and I mean, you can do that, but.
I mean, comparison will be inevitable because it is just normal to do an inquiry which is comparative. But yes, I was just wondering, I mean, if I was to design this out of scratch without any limitations, would I ever take Hungary and Portugal? And this started my dilemma. Would I have picked maybe Finland or an obvious choice or something that is a little bit less obvious like Ireland and so on? So this is a kind of a dilemma that is there.
I think that's great that these are the leading countries in innovation. And I have another reason that it's about Europe. Both countries are from the EU, and I think that's really important in our context in the EDITA program. And we should think about that also as a context.
I am thinking whether you couldn't consider to talk to those students who came from Kazakhstan. We have five Kazakh doctoral students, and one of them came from a school where, on the basis of what she said about it, one can observe wonderful processes of teacher learning in an innovative learning environment. So maybe you could use this.
Sure.
By the way, I would encourage especially the first and second year doctoral students to ask questions.
Yeah,
it's a unique opportunity for you to.
Sure. Just one thing to add out. I've been already feeling that there are many, many limitations during this dissertation project. Like, those which we just can't solve because it's a dissertation project and it's not a part of a larger research. And of course, this one is one of those, but there are many more limitations within this. But I'm sure that you should feel very lucky that you have two countries to be involved in. So yeah, just the only thing I wanted to add.
So we agree then that 15 minutes for each participant is a very limited time, but we should move on to the next doctoral student, Andres.
My computer. Sorry.
Okay. So we already heard yours, but it would be nice to have a really
my dilemmas. I'm really interested to learn a lot about the inner workings of the case study initial teacher education programs, but I was advised to concentrate on perceptions about the profession and readiness for the complexity of the job. I wonder if I could have some interview questions directly about the initial teacher education program, or I should trust that all really important issues will be necessarily brought up by the participants. Second question, I really love the idea of focus groups, but I'm only planning questionnaires and interviews here. Would a few group sessions bring valuable extra insights? And finally, everybody freaks out on the ethics side of these researches, and I'm not sure what the big deal is here. I ask consent, keep it all anonymity, destroy the files afterwards. Is there something I'm missing?
Don't destroy. Okay.
No, I just the keys, you know, the secret key that I have to, you know, I just destroy the key.
The file. The identification.
Yeah.
Okay.
No, not just that. The whole
logging
key, you know.
Okay. Yeah, I think I understand the questions. And we know that each participant is in different phase of the doctoral study. So I think it's totally fine. So we are developing, or you are developing, the doctoral research study, and we know this. So the comments are just helping you in developing further research studies. And the first that came to my mind that we said to Helena that you don't need to stick to one model because maybe it could be very limiting. But for you, I would say that you should find some model or some framework that can help you to understand those student teachers' views on learning experience and program, initial teacher education program experiences. So there are plenty of frameworks that you can use. So it's not really good to have a brainstorm opinion here, but it's just my idea, but there are lots of research studies on, for example, teachers' beliefs and how this is developing during initial teacher education program. What are the views and perceptions of teachers, teachers' work, and teachers themselves? So it can be also a conceptual framework. But there could be other frameworks, but I think you should try to find a framework which is broad enough, but which is really help you to focus on specific questions, because without that you think that all the answers will come up by the participants. The student teaching, but I don't think that's the case because you do the research, so you should know what you want to, what's your goal and what you want to get from these data. So I don't know if you want to add things about spaces.
The questions and four sense of Andrash are those of technical ones, mostly. I don't know, but when do you plan to begin the series of the interviews?
The interviews will be conducted between March and June 2018.
Mm-hmm. If you have such a technical dilemmas, I would suggest you have enough time to conduct some pilot interviews, and you will see, I think, 5 or 6 or 8 more questions in a qualitative deep interview, plus or minus, are not counting, because these interviews are lasting 1.5 or between 1.5 and 2 hours, so you will see. And I would recommend the focus group if you have so much time, but not one focus group, if possible, focus group in each country, and it would be helpful for you to set up the final list of the interview questions.
So the focus group before the interview sessions?
Another issue related to this design that maybe another point of view could be a quantitative measurement as well, because as far as I know, especially for teachers' professional development, there are a lot of questionnaires and questionnaire skills also available related to concept and belief, which is accessible, and you should use them, because your area, your topic is so much information in that after the interviews you can focus maybe deeply in other parts as well, on a larger scale, because then I think that your view should be a complete one. So you have mentioned that you are planning questionnaires. We haven't got any views about them, but I really suggest that when you check those frameworks in the literature, you will find questionnaires as well, on which you can adapt and use.
Maybe I would like to add something. We had four great presentations, and really thank you for that. So we really appreciate your work, and there are lots of new perspectives and results that were interesting for us also. But also, I'm always thinking about when I saw a presentation like this one, that what's new in those presentations. So what is that I'm really interested in, because I've never heard about that before. And in your case, Andrash, I don't feel what will be that. And I'm not sure if you know that already. And I think that's something that you should work on. For me, it's just a thought, an idea. I'm not sure about that. But the very different context of Hungarian and Portuguese teachers were really interesting for me. For example, this kind of system that they should move around in the country, and that they, for example, Hungary now, we have, I think we don't really have much problems, in Portugal there are more problems with getting teaching a job than in Hungary now. So it could be also interesting that these kinds of circumstances influence the perceptions of student teachers' learning and student teachers' beliefs on teacher profession and teachers' work. So that's just an idea. So we would like to ask.
That was an ethical issue. Maybe there are more than one ethical issue,
so maybe we can...
I would suggest you to check some books of research methodology in education, especially the Cohen, Mannion and Morrison's book. There are a lot of checklists of ethical issues which can arise during conducting any type of research. And there are much more than anonymity and destroying keys. So there are checklists, you go through them. It's from your beginning of research, how to find your interview, the persons of your interviews, and the end, of course, is how you end your data. And, there are a lot of things there. We don't have enough time to go through all of them, but I will put this book, which I have on the Padlet, so you can download it from there. And there's a whole section of ethical issues.
And there is a strict regulation in ATHA. I don't know about Lisbon, but we have a very strict regulation about the ethical issues that we have to go through step by step and have to prove the anonymity, the file containing which server it can. So there are several steps, and if you follow this regulation, it also can help to you do. But
well, we have one in Lisbon too. It's there is an ethical. Requirement, you have to fill in a form, and before you defend your proposal, you have to have the ethical board's permission. And I got that. So on that first level, it was okay. Mm-hmm.
This one is pretty detailed. The
actually, in ATHA, you should already have the tools and somehow explain
in Portugal as well. It's favorable if you have the tools. It's also there are some differences. For instance, in Portugal, anonymity has to be safeguarded at all times. So there's even the voice recording is not allowed if you're doing a school-based research. So everything needs to be either typed or written down, because apparently through the voice you can. But there are, as you say, there is some sort of complexity that is not similar, but different. So. I was wondering, there's something that I thought of when you suggested the focus group prior to, like, a pilot focus group. But in another study, you say that it could be possible to do a focus group to identify the question? So as a development of questionnaire or interview, in this case it would be to test the questions, I guess. In other
cases. Well, there's enough time for doing both.
Uh-huh, okay.
I was suggesting to help him himself with setting up the final list of questions in the full group.
Because this would be, I would love that. I knew this a year ago. This would be an interesting thing for me.
Everybody had these
is to what extent should I discuss what happens in the academic skills classes? Because I am indirectly looking at the effect of the instruction, but I don't want to put it into focus too much. So my question would be regarding the content, to what extent should I discuss it, or do I have to discuss it at all? Or can I omit my lesson plans, for example, from the discussion? And design related, the ethical issue I'm facing is that I am also the teacher and the researcher of the book. So in my dissertation proposal, this was one of the remarks that this could pose an ethical issue, and I agree that this can bias my subjectivity. And how can I handle this issue? Because I obviously cannot make it any differently now. I cannot choose another way where I am not the teacher. So if you can give me any advice on how to handle this issue. And the last one is, this is more sorry. So the methodology related dilemma is more about the think aloud method, and I don't know if anybody has used it and has any experience with it, but my personal experience is that some students tend to struggle more with verbalizing their thoughts, and I think this is an issue that we face in interviews, that some people are just not very talkative. And I think this might be something personality related. It doesn't have to do anything with language proficiency or anything, because these things go in Hungarian, so in their native language. But I think these people are generally just less talkative than others, and how can I encourage them without interfering with their answers? Mm-hmm. So without giving words into their mouth or something. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Maybe, and that was not clear for me during the presentation. So you are planning only to make the whole research for your dissertation in your own class?
Yes.
I think it would be not ideal. So mm-hmm. It should be a little bit enlarged, this field of investigation. It was in the second question. I was very, very pleased by your presentation because it was somehow new for me, this method, but this research field, it would be not adequate, I think.
Mm-hmm. So, what do you think? How many classes should I handle, or what would be?
Not only just one of your class, it's sure, but I don't know, you have to talk to colleagues and ask your supervisor or how much or how many does he or she suggest that it has to be over one. I cannot say that two is enough
mm-hmm.
or three is enough, but it would be better.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay, even in case of a case study?
Yes. For the whole dissertation.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so I think we can, so I have a different opinion on that, for example. Well, and maybe your supervisor also
mm-hmm.
Has different opinion on this question. But I think what's important for you now that you should not only focusing on research questions, but focusing on your goal.
Mm-hmm.
What is your main goal? Because if it's connected more to instruction and how to have students in reading strategies, then I would say you can have a really qualitative study. Like this would be for, I think a self study or something like that, a self study. But then if you want to move in that direction, then I think it's not enough to analyze what the students are doing this class, but also your teaching way. So if you are moving to this direction, and you have a, I don't know, a learning diary or something where you, you think about your teaching strategies, and maybe you can even develop your strategies during the whole process. But if you are moving to another direction that you want to understand what's really going in the student's brain, as you refer to, then I think what Balázs told you, that would be a more appropriate way. So I would think about your main goals and what would be more important for you. And I think this first one also can develop here in an educational doctoral school. So it can be also a way of handling this issue, but there are different goals to studies. I don't know, you want to...
Maybe that when you look on the literature and find the possibilities of methodology which you can use, you can check also maybe reading and reading strategies at all, and maybe there are some good methods in previous researches which you can use. I find, for example, this reading strategies inventory, which is quite a good questionnaire scale to involve. If you have a larger sample, maybe you are able to use some kind of questionnaire skills as well.
Thank you. Okay. I have a question here, because I think it was Agatha's question as well, that how much is it advisable to be involved in your own research as an instructor? So how much is that validated to be a researcher and a person who is doing intervention in your own research? Is it totally validated in a dissertation project, or?
Yes. There is our own field of research which is called ethnographic research.
Okay.
And Mészáros György is the main specialist in the building of this type of research. He published also a book about it, and these books are presenting the methods in detail, which consists being an actor and an investigator in the same time.
We also have one of our fellows who is doing investigation on active teaching, and she's basically coaching university professors to learn new methods to teach more effectively. And so her research is partly on the effect of her program, but also on the whole coaching process that she's doing. You just have to be much more self, I don't know, you really have to write about everything what goes through the whole thing, a little bit also on the inside, and also how it looks from the outside.
Yeah, so the validation, in qualitative research, it mostly focus on detailed descriptions of what is going on. So what are your goals, what you want to do, and the timeline is very important. So one thing that you are in the middle of this whole course, and you develop a new instructional strategies, for example, for And we have also other questions that we should answer. Maybe we can move on. I have one idea about the third one, that usually these kinds of metacognitive processes can also be explored by visualization. So I don't know if you thought about that, that there are lots of concept maps that are basically, for example, focusing on the structure of the text. And maybe can be helpful for you if someone is not really good in verbalizing his or her thoughts. Maybe this kind of visualization is a better way to. So this mind map, concept maps, for example, is my idea.
And you have mentioned several types that maybe the level of English knowledge is not an issue, but you cannot exclude this from your research, because maybe when you had in the paper, the first thing you were with question that what about the effect? And even if there's no effect, you, in order to make that statement, you should prove that. So unfortunately, you have to involve this.
It's only my personal experiences, but because I teach some kind of academic linguistics, but in Hungarian, it would be interesting to compare the with a Hungarian text and also with an English text, because as I understood you, that you think that the same student. Has the same strategy in the Hungarian text and in the English text. But I don't know, maybe there are lots of research studies on that, I don't know. But I think it would be interesting also, and also for me, the different types of texts. So sometimes in higher education there are more professional texts or scientific texts. And, as far as I understood, you used more like everyday
to point out the focus of these. So my first content-related dilemma is that there is, as I have already told you, the mentor certification became mandatory since 2011, and there are still teachers, senior teachers, who are mentoring students without certification, only because they are appointed on the basis of the university's decision. And my question is, how can I present a valid and balanced distinction between the concepts of these two groups of certified active and uncertified but active mentor teachers? So I already feel in my pilot research that there is a conceptual difference in their, so there is a difference in their concepts. There are two dilemmas concerning the design of my research. The first one is that the pilot research has already proved the need for data gathering about the conceptualization of mentoring processes on the level of teacher education centers. But my question is, who should provide valid information for this research project? Program directors or the teacher educators who teach students to teach? The program coordinators who have direct contact with the mentor teachers. And there is another question connected to this, which I think is always problematic, who in those researches concerning are using or involving teachers in their researches, what are the established and most effective ways of increasing the response rate in the large scale survey of mentor teachers, because these teachers are extremely busy and it's not easy to reach them with these questionnaires, especially not with online questionnaires. And the last question concerning the methodology part of my research is that there is the question of inclusion of student teachers in the study remains open. So I'm still concerning to somehow involve two student teachers into this research project. What would be a validated strategy for exploring the student teachers' reflection on the mentoring processes and the concept of an ideal mentor? Because basically I'm asking mentors about their concepts, and my research question are oriented to this direction. At which stage of the mentoring process would that be most relevant to ask these student teachers? I'm asking student teachers in pairs of their mentors, but I'm still thinking about asking them separately. But in that case, that would be not matched to the mentor's concept, if that's clear, more or less. Yeah.
At first, we have a clarifying question that how much is the population of yours? It's 1,400 or
400.
400.
Okay.
The population,
not
the sample.
Yeah, the sample is 400, and the population is 14.
14.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, sorry. Yeah, excuse me.
Okay. So the sample, and how can you reach maybe more mentor teachers? If you reach some contact persons within institutes who has access to these mentor teachers, would be a good idea, and you should bring them to your purpose. If they are academic personnel, you can provide them some kind of co-authorship in one publication in the future or something. That would be a good idea, that ask them to hand out your question, and not if outsider sends someone an email with an online questionnaire, that won't be a good ratio. But if you ask some persons who are directly contacted with these mentors, that should be a good scenario. And when you do a pilot study, in order related to that, when you do a pilot study, you should provide a detailed feedback, show them how good is your work and how can it be used for practical issues, for example, that institute. Then maybe the institute will be motivated to continue this research and provide you the data. So maybe.
The small sample researches are not that difficult because I have personal relations to them, so it works. But I don't know if you have ever heard about the data jealousy of this institute. So they are not very open to hand out information of their own mentors because they are also doing research on them. And because these mentors are very busy, they try to keep them for themselves. So
yeah.
I find it very difficult to reach those mentors. It seemed very easy at the first stage because I had personal relations to them. But when I'm thinking in a broader sense and in a bigger sample, it seems very difficult for me.
Do they have a community, for example?
No, they don't really have. They have communities connected to the universities.
Oh.
Not really. So there is one community, I think. I'm not sure. You know about the Hungarian teacher educators association. I don't know the English name. And there is a subgroup of mentors. And as far as I know, that group is the biggest group in our association. So the number of
conducting the pilot research, they are not part of this community, and I'm not sure about the activity of this community, how active they are.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so in this association, within this association, they are active, but I don't know regarding research materials, but I know, of course, that they also want to conduct research on their work. Well, yes, I understand this situation here in Hungary, and I don't know if you have been thinking about moving to some kind of cooperation between the other institutes. Because I think, yes, that also in Szeged and in other institutes, there are really a special framework for mentoring, and the higher education institutes think about these mentoring programs as some kind of as their own work and their own development, and maybe it would be also interesting to compare these kinds of programs. And I know that it's not easy, but I think in that case the cooperation could be better than try to, I don't know, have only the participants involved in those other programs. And I would like to add some other thing that it was connected to the first question that you thought about, that there are two types of mentors, certified active and uncertified but active. But what do you think about the experiences of those mentors? Because for me it could be a very important factor that, for example, there is a mentor who practiced mentoring for 10 years, or she or he just started with a certification last year. So I don't know if you are thinking about it. There is not two sub-samples, but there are different factors that can influence.
Just what I observe, what I perceive, that their concepts are different if they have gone through a training for a year or for 2 years, and if not, even if they are experienced or not experienced. But yes, that's a very good idea to take that into account.
The same thing, yeah, well, when it's 1400, you should connect the same thing with your goals and questions in order to answer them. If you want to do some kind of comparisons between institutes, of course you need to think about the proportions. But when you select your sample, you should think about them. How many subgroups do you want to compare? Because in each subgroup should be at least 100 persons. But it's not a strict rule, but you need to think about that as well.
I didn't intend to compare them, but yeah.
If, for example, age groups, if you want to
compare them. Or the experience.
Is there any difference between different subject teachers, like, I don't know, human subjects and STEM subjects?
In the training, no, but their concepts are pretty different. So there is a disciplinary distinction between them. I am not really want to go into that.
So if there are already some groups and subjects, so you should be able to think about them too.
Yeah, it's just there. There are like four or five mentor teachers mentoring in physics in Budapest, for example, or in the field of science.
You can make groups as mathematics and science and humanities and language.
Yeah.
I don't know if it would be possible, but maybe it would be interesting to connect.
That's a bomb.
Terrorist attack.
The connect the clearness of the concept in the head of the teachers to the implemented features to their effectiveness, if it is possible. Maybe another one has not so clear concepts from the new plans in education, that it is possible that he or she works in a more effective manner than the young ones who are coming out from school with the new ideas and new concepts, and that aspect I think would be interesting if it would be possible to connect or involve.
Effectiveness based on self-perception, or
that's what I don't know. Or I don't know if is there some measurement system, evaluation system of these mentor teachers with this quantified. If there is such quantified system, it is easier. If not, it's more. You are the expert in the question.
Well, seemingly. Thank you.
Is it a final
No, nobody knows anything. It seems like it was such a short thing that it's probably just an electric thing.
And related to your blank questioner, when you do your design and construction of this questioner, I suggest you to try Likert types of questions as well to make sure that you will be able to do higher level of data analysis in the future. And as far as I see, you are planning to publish your research in international journals, and with your topic and with the higher type of analysis, that should be reached.
Thank you for reassuring that what we are planning to do.
Otherwise, this can, if there is no other questions, because this panel is going to study.
Sorry, excuse me.
Because you mentioned that you used the phenomenal graphy, so it's a very interesting and not easy way of analyzing in qualitative research studies, we haven't seen your results. So can you just I don't know in which phase are you in the analysis of this study, but we are really eager to hear something about the results.
Yeah, so I've already finished analyzing this part of my research, which I'm using PhenoGraph for. And yeah, it's a complex approach, and it was very difficult to me as well to apply it, actually, because it has different phase. It has a very strict phases to go through to get validated data at the end. So what we found is that there are certain categories emerging from the interview transcriptions that we can settle our questionnaire around. And these were the four categories that I've just projected to you. And these are the ones which emerged the most often in the transcription of these interviews. We didn't want to predefine categories, and this is actually a rule for this approach. So we haven't predefined certain categories, but what we did is we reflected on the data we had once, and then we condensed the data and we reflected on the condensation again, and we tried to explain why we tried to find explanation why we found different categories, and we tried to put all the data we got, findings, or the most often mentioned issues into one category, and that's how we found four containers or four categories relevant to that our later survey. It's a very superficial what I'm telling now, but
I can show you, hopefully I can show you our paper soon on this. I don't know if that was enough for now or...
Yeah, of course, I was just interested in the, for example, the different types of roles that they talked about, but...
That was the circulation I just showed for a very short time.
I think our time is up. And then thank you for everybody for the contributions, for the observation also. And maybe we'll meet in the other
yes.
room.
Yes, okay. 10 minutes, and then we are going to show what we found here, what we discussed here.
Okay. So please.